The next group of toxins and detoxification that I want to talk about is what I'm calling the mucosal surfaces. So mucosa just means any of your moist environments, anywhere that you have damp or warm environments. And so the nose, the mouth, the lungs, the ears, your gut, of course, genital areas, all of those are considered mucosal surfaces. And these mucosal surfaces are important where we share our environment with the outside, the bacteria, the fungus, the mold, everything in our environment. We must share that space and we need those guys to be there and gals. But you can't have too many of them or you have a problem, and you can't have too little of them or you have a problem. So once again, we're back to this homeostasis or this balance. So as you probably know from me already, gut is the biggest one. And I'm just going to kind of simplify that down to, you can watch my biofilm video on how to treat that. But gut is number one. So that's why I've actually left it on the side as number three. So I'd pay attention to some of these other ones. And it's too easy to look at the gut and only focus on the gut and miss these other ones. So let's start there. So first, I want to mention the sinus and lungs, so your respiratory tract. The sinus and lungs frequently get overlooked as potential sources of biological toxins. We seem to forget that whatever happens at the dentist stays at the dentist and doesn't make it to the doctor's office. Well, I can guarantee you that if you're going to see your dentist and he's asking you to do frequent cleanings or deep cleanings or all the things dentists do that I don't fully understand yet, then you probably have a problem. You have a problem with your oral microbiome. So we're constantly talking about the microbiome of the bowels, but everywhere where you have a moist mucosal environment, you have a totally different microbiome. For instance, you have an ocular, an eyeball microbiome that's just as important as the other ones. There's very little research in this, but I suspect that it will be part of macular degeneration and glaucoma and blindness and all the other things that go along with it. We're not there yet. We're not going to get too distracted. So back to the sinus and lungs. You can have things in the respiratory tract that can grow inside you. It may not be bad enough to have an infection where a conventional doctor would listen to your lungs and say, oh, I can hear some noises in there. Let's do a chest x-ray or CAT scan. Let's look for that infection. This is going to be a shared environment, a low-grade inflammation from some of these inhabitants that are causing a problem. And if you don't eradicate those, then they're constantly a source of inflammation. A very simple way to explain this, I was taught in regular conventional medical school, is people with dental disease have earlier heart attacks. And it seems so striking, like the heart has nothing to do with teeth. The heart doesn't have any teeth. So how can you have chronic inflammation in your mouth that causes heart disease? That's it. You've got chronic inflammation. And anytime you have chronic inflammation here, it sets off inflammatory pathways everywhere in your body. So then you're predisposed to almost all disease. And the number one thing that's a killer is strokes and heart attacks. So that's why that's the link between any chronic inflammation and disease, whether it be autoimmunity, cancer, heart attack, strokes, whatever it may be, inflammation lies at the base of all of it. So to the sinus and lungs, we could talk about this forever, but I want to point out a few things. Number one is Marcons. This is relatively new to the scene, but important. Marcon stands for multiple antibiotic resistant coagulase negative staphylococcus. That does not matter so much. It just makes me look smart to say it all. But Marcons is basically a very nasty bacteria that lives in your sinuses, loves to live there. It's kind of like MRSA, which is also on my list, MRSA, which is methicillin resistant staph aureus. Almost everyone knows about MRSA, growing an abscess or some sort of infection on your skin of some sort that needs to be drained. Everyone knows that MRSA is a really bad bacteria, really hard to eradicate because of its antibiotic resistance. Well, think of Marcons as its tougher older brother. So Marcons is called Marcons because it's multiple antibiotic resistant. MRSA is usually just methicillin resistant, although it is growing over time to be multiple antibiotic resistant. But Marcons is always multiple antibiotic resistant. It is a staphylococcus bacteria, similar to MRSA, but it loves to live in the sinuses, but not so much create an infection. So why is this guy such a big problem? This guy is such a big problem because he loves to create biofilms. These biofilms are protective fortresses, shelters for other organisms to hide in as well as them. And so this biofilm becomes this chronic inflammatory source because your body has this built up Marcons living on its mucosal surfaces and is trying to get rid of it. It's constantly trying to throw immune white blood cells at it, trying to kill it, but ultimately it can't ever kill it. It can't penetrate the biofilm, and this Marcon survives. So not enough to create an infection where your body needs to kill it, but enough to create this low-grade chronic inflammation. So this Marcons is really difficult to eradicate, and it lives all in your sinuses. So if you're someone that has chronic allergies or runny nose or nasal drip or dripping in the back of your throat that causes reflux, or you've had to have multiple sinuplasties where they go in and drain things and balloon your sinuses, maybe you should investigate if you have Marcon's. It's a really simple swab. It feels terrible, but we swab your nose, both sides, and we send it to a lab to see if you have Marcon's, and then we have to treat it appropriately. Next thing that loves to live in the sinuses, and this sounds absolutely crazy, is mold. You can breathe mold. Mold loves warm, wet environments, right? So if you live in Texas and you have a wet wall and it is moist, obviously, and it is warm enough, it will grow mold. So is it really that crazy to think that mold could grow inside of you? Mold grows on your bread. It grows on food that you leave out. Why can't it grow on you? So mold can actually grow inside you. This actually happened to a patient of mine fairly recently. She kept getting sinus infections. No one could really figure it out. We finally had an ENT go in, take a swab, and then she ultimately had sinuplasty to kind of fix it all. But 4 weeks later, I got the culture back that said she actually grew mold in her sinuses. So we were trying to treat for the mold, but getting inside the sinuses was difficult, and she ultimately had to have a procedure to fix it. But that's how difficult mold can be to eradicate. So we can't forget about mold in the sinuses. Yes, we'll talk about mold in office buildings and homes and all that as being important. But growing mold inside you is way worse than mold that you could be exposed to indoors. So the three things I want you to think about in the sinuses, and once again, are Marcon's, mold, and MRSA. So how do we treat these things? Well, it's difficult, first of all. But the main things we tend to use are biocide and LSF. You're going to hear me kind of a spokesperson for biocide, and I make no money. I have no investment in biocide as a company. But this biocide and LSF stuff, the way we use it is you can't obviously squirt it in your nose. So one of the things we do with this biocide is we actually put it in a sinus rinse, one of the Neomed sinus rinses. These Neomed sinus rinses you can get from the pharmacy or Amazon or whatever. And I always make sure to put the salt packet on the side. So I remember to remind you, put the salt packet in. But you can put biocide in this sinus rinse. So you put two pumps of biocide in this, and then you rinse it through your sinuses. Biocide, as you've probably seen in some of my other videos, is a herbal tincture that kills bacteria, fungus, mold, anything of that sort. So when you're rinsing it through your sinuses, you're disrupting that biofilm, you're disrupting the mold, you're disrupting that Marcon's. It's really disrupting anything and everything in there. And that's what will hopefully get you to reset your microbiome so that you can get to feeling better, clearing those things out. What we'll ultimately do for people with MRSA, because sometimes the biocide can't kill it, so if they're struggling with infections on their skin, we will actually use mupirocin, an antibiotic ointment. This is commonly used in conventional medicine. It's not that crazy. So we use mupirocin ointment, and you actually put it on a Q-tip, or you can put it on your finger, however you want to, and just insert it into the tips of your nose. MRSA loves to live in the tips of your nose, and that's where it survives. And anytime you go to rub your nose and rub your skin, you're basically exposing your whole body to MRSA. So we'll actually do mupirocin in the nares or tips of the nose in order to kill the MRSA. Next on the list is lungs, and there's many things that can go wrong in the lungs. Of course, you can grow mold there. You can grow all kinds of fungi, sand, fungus, and all kinds of things that I don't really see in Texas too often, but lots can go wrong in the lungs. The thing I most commonly test for and see is something called mycoplasma. Mycoplasma is a inappropriately named bacteria. First, we thought it was a fungus, which is why I got the myco name. Anything myco usually means fungus, which is why the mold test is called mycotox. And so we thought it was a fungus because it looks kind of funny, but ultimately they found out, oh, hey, that's a bacteria. We need to update its classification. But it's still called mycoplasma because it grows very slowly, loves to live in our respiratory surfaces. So this mycoplasma bacteria frequently is the cause of walking pneumonia. So if you've ever known someone have walking pneumonia, ever heard of walking pneumonia, this is one of the common culprits of walking pneumonia. The problem is that after your walking pneumonia, you can actually have a chronic pneumonia. So it could have been a cough or cold that passed, no big deal, but now you're growing this mycoplasma in your respiratory tract and you can't seem to get rid of it. So mycoplasma can be a tough little guy. If you, same thing as far as the sinuses, if you've got chronic allergies or a chronic cough or anything going on that may be affecting your lungs, you should consider mycoplasma. We will frequently use biocide and LSF, once again, the biocide and pumper. This one you can put in your mouth because it is absorbed in order to treat the mycoplasma. So we do two or three pumps in the mouth twice a day in order to start treating the mycoplasma in your lungs. You can also nebulize biocide through a nebulizer. You can't use that liposomal one. You got to use a regular one. And it depends on what kind of nebulizer you use, but you can use 4 to 10 drops in the nebulizer and breathe it in and try to kill some of the fungus bacteria that may be growing in your lungs. If we can't get the mycoplasma levels down, and by the way, how do we test for that? We test for that through blood, through IgM and IgG testing. I generally consider people's, if their IgG level is over 1.5, I consider them as having a chronic infection. And then we treat them with biocidin and see if it comes down. And then last but not least, if we're not making progress on it and they're still having those lung symptoms, we will actually use antibiotics, azithromycin. As you probably know, and as a functional medicine doctor, we don't like using antibiotics. So unfortunately, when we have to use it, we will, of course, protect the gut as much as possible, but we have to get rid of that organism in order to make forward progress. So we will use azithromycin, and sometimes we have to do a 30-day course in order to ultimately eradicate it. So that's it on the sinus and lungs. There's many other things we can talk about, but let's move on to mouth and teeth. Now, going through conventional medical school, we are not taught a lot about dental stuff and mouth and oral care in general, other than brush your teeth and floss, and if you have any issues, go see the dentist. So I've learned a lot in functional medicine as far as the mouth and teeth, and I want to learn a lot more. But so far, it is eminently important to your health, even though I may not be able to explain everything, ask a dentist, right? So first thing on my list is see a dentist, because they know more about this than I do. But your mouth and teeth are really important. I like to compare it to, if you've ever heard of anyone having an open fracture, which is where when you break a bone, your bone sticks out of your body, and then you can reset it and pull it back in your skin and fix the bone and all that. But an open fracture complicates things immensely. You've now taken an inner part of your bone and exposed it to the outside, exposed it to bacteria and fungus and everything in the air, and then you've pulled it back into inside of your body. So your risk for infection is dramatically increased with that. Well, imagine if you had bones sticking out of your tissue at all times. That would be an obvious source of possible infection that's difficult to eradicate. One of the reasons it's difficult to eradicate is because bone doesn't change very quickly. Yes, it's alive and well and growing, but it grows so slowly. There's so little blood flow. It's really hard to fight an infection off. And so basically your teeth are a portal into your bloodstream for bacteria and fungus to have a shelter, a bunker, in order to keep launching an attack to eventually get inside your body. So take care of your teeth. But more importantly, if you have plaque buildup in your teeth, so the vocabulary we use in the teeth, we say plaque or we say tartar, that's buildup around your teeth. That's nothing more than a biofilm. So we talk about biofilms in the gut. We talk about biofilms in the sinuses and lungs. But plaque and tartar on your teeth is just a plaque, a biofilm. That's all it is. So we're using a different word, but it's the same thing. If you have too much tartar or too much plaque in your teeth, you have a biofilm in your mouth, and that's a problem. You're harboring bad organisms, whether it's fungus, whether it's bacteria, whatever it may be. They're using the calcium and thing and proteins in your saliva and building this hard structure, this plaque that can't even be getting rid of with a toothbrush. I mean, if you brush your teeth twice a day and you floss every day, you can still develop plaque and tartar. Every time I go to the dentist, every 6 months, they're still scratching stuff off. I hate that noise. But if I'm flossing and brushing my teeth every day, which I'm not perfect, how are they still scraping stuff off? That's how tough a biofilm can be. Now, unfortunately for the gut and for the sinuses, we can't exactly stick a toothbrush in there, so we have to get a little more creative. But that's how resistant a biofilm can be, and that's how hard it can be to get rid of. So first and foremost, the teeth stick out. So go to the dentist, scrape that stuff off. That's the easiest thing to treat. But don't ignore if they're asking you to do more frequent cleanings or deep cleanings. It says that you've got a resistant biofilm and you should consider treating that a little deeper. And what I would recommend in that is the same company, Biocidin, has gone after the dental world and they've made a couple products. So one is a Biocidin toothpaste. They call it Dentalcidin. So the idea here is that Biocidin has proven themselves to disrupt biofilms. So they've put it into a toothpaste fashion so that as you're brushing, you're actually disrupting that biofilm. You're disrupting the bacteria and fungus in order to let your own immune system take over and fix some of those problems. And then they also came out with a oral solution that you can spray in there and kind of wash around in order to continue disrupting the biofilms. So don't neglect your teeth and your mouth. I guess one last point I've got here is gingivitis. If you have gum inflammation, if you bleed when you brush your teeth, if when you go to the dentist and they measure your dental pockets, which if they're not doing, you need to find a new dentist that's measuring the pockets between the teeth and the gums. If your pockets are too deep, obviously that's a problem. You've got bacteria and fungus hiding down in those pockets, creating chronic inflammation and actually eroding away your gums. So you need to treat that dysfunctional microbiome in order to regenerate your gums and your dental health. So the mouth and teeth are very important. Once again, guys, we're talking about biological toxins. How did we get down to teeth and the dentist when we're dealing with biological toxins? If you've got a busted up mouth and you've got tons of bacteria and fungus creating toxins, you're swallowing those toxins. You're absorbing them through your gums. Your liver has to Your liver has to deal with all those things, and it can only deal with so many things at once. So if your human body wants to feel better, you got to get rid of all the other toxic sources in your life. Okay, off my soapbox. Next one, I'll keep it brief. The gut, I want to do way more videos on the gut because it's so important. And the current one I've got that's the best one is the biofilm video. You should just be able to put that in YouTube and find my biofilm video. So real quickly, how do you test for the gut? You do a stool study. That's one of my favorite tests to do for the gut is if you've got a gut problem, you got to collect some of the output in order to find out what's going on. And the gut only makes one output, and it's called stool. It's disgusting. It's gross. It's not fun. But you've got to do an advanced stool study. And I'm not talking about one of those crappy ones, pun intended, at Quest where you just get ovum parasites. You need to do the full deal, the elastase. You need to look at the microbiome. You need to look at, are there inflammatory markers like calprotectin? Is there leaky gut markers? Is there yeast under the microscope? What's growing under the culture? So you've got to do one of those advanced stool studies. We use Genova and sometimes Doctor's Data for the stool study. We use GI Effects currently, and it's a great test. I also have the Oat and Nutrival, which were also listed over here in the human toxins. The Oat and Nutrival have some really good gut markers, I find. So Oat is my higher marked one here. The Oat is a better test in the realm of gut testing. It's really good at picking up yeast. As far as how to treat it, look up my biofilm video. I won't reiterate that. You can watch that video separately. And then the mold is the last biological toxin on here. And I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about mold because I think mold is so critical that it deserves its own video, and I've already ranted long enough here. But real quickly, we'll talk about mold toxins. The way you test for it is you do a mold test on the human. Humans are actually way easier to test for mold than the buildings they live in. So you do a mycotox test. You can get that at Great Plains Labs. And this mycotox test can actually tell you what toxins you're urinating. Now, it's very important here. You can be exposed to as much mold as you want to, but if your liver's not actually clearing it and putting it in the liver, your levels may look falsely low. And in general, what we've seen is no matter how broken the human, if they're exposed to enough mold, some will end up in the urine. But if you want to really find out if your mold test is good, you want to do it fast, and you want to ramp up your detox pathways to make sure you're eliminating those mold toxins into your urine. And then how do you treat the mold? Well, that is a very complex problem, and we will be addressing that. But real simply, let me get out of the way, you're going to use binders, methylation and glutathione, and oil pushers. Kind of this binding, pulling, and pushing mentality. And once again, in my detox video, I'll go over each of these in much more detail. So that's my short spiel on biological toxins as far as human mucosal surfaces and mold. And we'll go into more depth on mold in a separate video. I hope this was helpful. Feel free to leave any questions, comments. I will do my best to answer them. If not, I hope this was helpful for you.